Today, I'm gonna show you how to turn an inexpensive vintage store dresser into an actual useful shop storage unit. And I'm Rachel, and I know you've seen a lot of these videos, and some of you actually saw this come together live. We have these live build hangouts where we can ask questions. Most of all, we just kind of chat back and forth as I work on these projects. But I'm always trying to find ways to improve the shop. Storage is always a huge problem, especially when you're working in a tiny, tiny place. So you can probably see off camera here, kind of in this area, my red toolbox, and of course behind the camera is my big black tower toolbox, and these hold kind of my heavy items like my automotive stuff, my home stuff. But then I kind of needed something for small bits or things for electronics, props, those kinds of projects. And I didn't want to buy a whole other toolbox. They're expensive, and I always keep my eye out on like a Craigslist or an eBay. Sometimes you can get good deals, but the best deals, I'm gonna tell you guys a secret, is to get them at your local vintage shop. So I have, or thrift store. So I have a thrift store here that I love because there's always really cool things that you just can't find anywhere else. And believe me, old tools work the best. I love old tools. So I wanted an option for kind of like a crafting slash electronics type of thing. And I found this old dresser, and I used it like that for the longest time. But then as I decorated it and this kind of became my woman cave, I decided, man, I need to do something that, I don't know, has a little more personality. So I decided on a really cool theme, which is basically the most debated theoretical battle of all time, because this has never officially happened. But who would win in a fight between Superman and Goku? I don't know, the choice is yours. And this was a super fun project because, of course, well, we all know Superman, and like Goku, both of them have flight, super speed, super sight, super hearing, all those great super things, invulnerability. And of course, Superman has his heat rays from his eyes. He's got X-ray vision, freeze breath. I don't know, I would kind of take care of that before going on a date, but okay. And then Goku, it's interesting because the source of his powers comes from a lot of mysticism. So all beings in their world have ki, which is your personal kind of energy source. And they can channel that ki into an energy ball and through a Kamehameha attack, throw that ball, like launch it at their adversaries. So my biggest question between this, why this debate even exists, is because these characters are actually a lot alike. And we'll get into the making of this chest and stuff. But in the beginning, we got to answer the question, what's the point between pitting these two together? And that's something that I'm still trying to figure out. Because on the one hand, you have Clark Kent. And of course, he's from planet Krypton. And he was born Kal-El. And his parents sent him off in a spaceship because the planet was dying. It was crumbling. It was going to explode. And they wanted to save their only son, send him off. And of course, he was found by an amazing couple that raised him, taught him good morals, and basically to use his powers for good. And on the other hand, we have Goku with a really similar story, also sent off to Earth. His planet was also dying, but a little bit different kind of beginnings, because an elderly couple found him and decided to raise him as their grandchild. Well, Goku later learns that he's from a race of super, like, extraterrestrial warriors called Saiyans, and they're kind of mean, actually. So he was sent on a mission to go in and destroy Earth. And so his elderly grandparents were like, man, we're having a tough time with this kid, like terrible twos level issues. Well, one day he gets in an accident, hits his head, and gets permanent amnesia. So good for the planet and all that. All of a sudden, his grandparents begin to teach him respect, compassion for others, and Goku learns to just absolutely love planet Earth, and he'll do anything to protect it. But also in the Dragon Ball Z world, your skills as a warrior is also very important. So he's the kind of guy that's just like training all the time to become better. He has very little guidance because he didn't really grow up on his planet, much like Clark Kent here. And so the both of them are kind of learning as they go. The big key difference, though, is that Clark is kind of born with all his powers, and through life he's got to figure out how to use them, you know, preferably for good. And Goku is born with some power as a Saiyan, of course, because he is. But as he battles, he actually levels up his powers, and there's various Saiyan levels. So this kind of adds a degree of complexity to who would actually win in a fight between these two. Because the Goku you're fighting in the beginning, well, he could level up on you and cause some issues there. So think about that. But more importantly, how did this all come about? So once I got the dresser home, I figured the first thing I'm gonna do is just get all the original paint, which was a beautiful cherry finish. So let's check me out removing handles and all of the prep that happened for that. And so yeah, first things first, I really debated about these handles because I love the gold color on them. It's kind of like old, and you know, I debated using wood putty to fill in the holes and getting new handles, but at this stage I figured keep them for now. So I hit this whole thing up with the DA sander, and the objective is just to go with the grain of the wood. And this is especially important if you're gonna stain the thing. So if you're gonna paint it, you don't have to get all of the original varnish or finish off if it was previously painted. You just wanna scuff it up a bit. But because at this time I didn't quite know which direction I was gonna go, I was trying to get most of it off. So between like an 80 grit or 100 grit sandpaper, that's kind of what I used to get it. And of course, for all those really intricate areas, you kind of have to just jump and go by hand, folding that piece of paper every which little origami way that you can to get in all the little crevices. So this was probably the most fun, as in not at all, like, you know, air quote fun part of this project. The sanding, like working on a car, is always the toughest part and the most time consuming part, but prep is really what's going to give you the best end result in the end. So you want to put in the time. So after everything was sanded, I really debated between staining it, which is most of the time a three-step process. You have to condition the wood, pre-treat the wood. Then you have to stain it to the level that you want. And then you have to finish it. You clear coat it to protect it. And man, I thought if we were gonna go with really bright color panels, I decided, you know what? A black color would really just showcase this. So check out kind of what I picked for the black here. You can do basically any type of paint. You can use just regular furniture paint. They have a lot of specialty kits that you can use to weather it, make it look like the paint is cracking, and it's, you know, a multi-step process. But I ended up finding this cool, like, chalk type of finish, and what's neat about it is that it makes the dresser look kind of antique, like it's been around for a while, like a age-old battle of some sorts. And so what I did here is that with that type of paint, one coat absolutely looks the best. You could do two, but I thought that one coat looks best. And so with just one dip of the brush, I try to stretch that paint out as far as I can stretch it, and you can really see some of the grain taking hold of it, which was really neat. And finally, I got kind of that finish that I wanted and decided, yeah, one coat was enough. Now, really important, if you're in a shop environment, you might want to put a finishing coat on it to protect it, because, you know, it's going to get knocked around. But because this is a special theme battle dresser, I figured, you know what, it's gotta wear its battles, much like Superman and Goku do through their various battles. So with the drawers, I figured one kind of light coat was enough because I was gonna cover it with panes anyways of, you know, all my favorite battle scenes. So then came the part where I have to figure, between Goku and Superman, of course, officially, they've never fought. You can find some fan art if you wanna do, you know, pictures of them fighting. So I decided to take my most favorite iconic Superman fights, and of course, iconic Goku fights, and kind of display them on the drawer. So you can do a collage where it's all kind of thrown about. I decided to pick panels where I thought the fight was just going on. It was like the best panel to illustrate the fight. So you can rummage through a bargain bin. You can buy the actual comics online. But for me, these drawers have specific heights. So I figure, you know what? The best thing to do is probably print them out. So you can see like some of the printouts that I had going on, and you can do this on your home computer. And so the paper that I was using wasn't like, you know, just basic printer paper, but it was not like that high gloss photo stock either. And it wasn't cardstock. It was something in between regular paper and a cardstock. And so I cut out all of my favorite scenes on the computer. I sized them exactly so they would fit the drawers. And then now to get these things on there, well, I could glue them on and maybe I can clear coat the rest of it to really protect just the panes. Well, through some of my research, I found that a lot of crafters actually use this product right here, and it's called Mod Podge. And when you open it up, at first I was kind of disappointed because as you're seeing it go on, it looks like glue. And I thought, man, you know, glue is just gonna dry like this milky white, and it's really gonna take away from the color and vibrancy of the panes. Well, it's actually a glue and a sealer, and you can choose different finishes. Matte, gloss, which I went with here. You can choose pearl. You can choose metallics to give it kind of like a nice glitter glow if you want, but this is a battle. Ain't no glitter in battle. That, you know, put the glitter aside. So I went with a gloss finish, applied it with a brush, and then after it was all dried, I went ahead and brushed over it to protect the different panes. Now, there's a couple different finishing options. I really like being able to see some of the rough brush textures over the panes. Now, if you're doing a more high-end item, like think about like a coffee table or an end table where you want that polished glass look, well, it turns out you can do that with this stuff too. So you just want to apply more layers, like 5 good coats, and then sand it, wet sand it with 400-ish grit, you know, sandpaper, I would say. And that would give you a more mirror appearance. But I figured for a shop, it helps kind of the look of the vintage, battle-y, worn type of look. I like the brush strokes. So after that, well, let's get the handles on this thing, right? So I have all my battle scenes, and I decided to stick with the handles that I had in the end. It turns out that the gold really makes these colors pop. I love the way it turned out, and I love kind of the like Asian inspiration behind these handles. It kind of brings like the Goku world in. And I think maybe the only thing I would change is the top two knobs, because it is a single hole per knob. Maybe doing like a Goku Dragon Ball on one knob, and then maybe a Superman kind of kryptonite looking knob on this end, just to kind of tie the whole thing together. But I'm thinking that, you know, the gold really kind of accentuated everything. So I was happy with the way this turned out. All of the Mod Podge was dry. You can see some of the previews of the battle scenes that I picked out, both from the Goku world and from the Superman world. Maybe some of them there, your favorites too. Maybe there's some on there that you're like, why didn't that make the cut? Well, let's find out. So here's what the dresser looked like as a side-by-side from when I first brought it to the shop, and then what it looks like now. So you can see what I'm talking about. It was kind of old, beaten, you know what? Perfect for a shop, really. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. It's great for housing all of my electronics, glue guns, soldering equipment, which is pretty light. All that goes in here. But why not spice it up? After all, I spend so much time in the shop, you know, you want to have some fun. So you can see how the dresser turned out in the end on the right hand side there, or on my left now. So let's take a closer look at some of the battle scenes that I ended up picking. What made the cut? So let's look at this top drawer right here first. Well, this one I just put first because this is just one of the most iconic. I remember, you know, when I was younger reading this book with Superman versus Doomsday. And some of you are already like, oh, we know what this battle is about. So of course, oftentimes in the Goku and Superman world, they kind of fight each other a lot of times, Kryptonian versus Kryptonian. Well, this is a prehistoric Kryptonian beast. And he comes about, he just wants to destroy everything because bad guys, equals destroying stuff. That's just kind of what they all want to do. And so he ends up on Earth, and the Justice League tries to take him out first. Well, he annihilates them in minutes. Even Supergirl tries to get involved, and he just like punches her out, and she gets knocked out. And he just becomes obsessed with Superman because he's like, man, this is like a formidable foe, and he's just way into violence. And the whole thing is being televised because Doomsday's name wasn't always Doomsday. I believe he was called something like the Ultimate. I'm just going from kind of younger memory here, so correct me if I'm wrong. But the reason he inherited the name Doomsday was because no one could defeat this guy, and everywhere he went, he just like annihilated into rubble. So it basically looked like Doomsday was coming, and Doomsday was coming for Superman. So he decided, well, I gotta stop this guy before he reaches Metropolis because he's gonna annihilate my beloved city. And he really tries, and the both of them are very evenly matched until Superman realizes that this guy is getting stronger as time moves on. So he's gotta defeat him like now before he gets any stronger. And the fight unfortunately does end up in Metropolis, and the big finale happens right in front of the Daily Planet, which is where Clark Kent works. And they pummel each other, and it ends with Lois Lane. Major spoilers here, so now's the time. La la la. Okay, this whole thing is a bunch of spoilers. But I don't feel bad for you because you should know some of these iconic things by now. Come on. So Lois Lane is holding Superman, and he's just, you know, bleeding and not looking so great, and he dies. And I remember like turning back the pages. Hopefully I had missed something. Maybe Superman had cloned himself and this was his clone that died. But no, we were definitely led to believe that Superman was dead, and it was just devastating. I was like, oh my gosh, is the comic over? So that was one of my favorite battles because the ending of it was just so unexpected at the time, especially. And now, of course, we gotta parallel that with, we got two Kryptonians, even though one was super prehistoric. We got two Planet Vegeta guys, and so we have Vegeta, who is named after his planet, and Goku. And these guys are like two brothers that just can't stop fighting. And Vegeta is probably one of my favorite characters in the whole Goku universe because he's always just teasing Goku. I think he tries to make him feel inferior all the time and tells him, oh, the reason you were sent to Earth was because your Saiyan power is so low, and constantly egging him on. They're fighting all the time. But through their fights is really Goku's opportunity to level up again with his ki. And so they can go to Kaioken levels, which increases their power and their ki temporarily. They turn all red and stuff. But also it comes at a cost because any damage they take on really affects them. So they're constantly fighting. They're very affected by phases of the moon. At one point, Vegeta turns into a great ape, which is like a super powerful form. And Goku rips off his tail, which, you know, poor Vegeta, but constantly going at it. And of course, no battle dresser is complete with this Prime Superman battle. And this is Superman versus Batman. Now, I love these two characters. They're constantly going at it. So which of the Superman and Batman fights are the best? My personal favorite is from The Dark Knight Rises, because this really reminds me of that movie Logan, where Professor X and Wolverine are much older and they're kind of feeling the effects of their age on their crime fighting abilities. So we have a much older Batman now, and he decides, I'm coming out of retirement. You know, and he knows there's all these super villains. The world is kind of a darker place. And so this is probably one of the most technologically advanced Batmans that we see in the comics. He's got a super hydraulic suit, sonic technology. He's got like electric gauntlets and kryptonite arrows. Thank you, Green Arrow. Not. So basically, Batman comes out of retirement. He starts like crime fighting. The problem is that the US military is looking at this like, he's kind of blurring that line between crime fighting and just plain being violent, you know? So they send Superman and they tell him, listen, just bring him to justice, you know? And Superman in his goody two-shoe ways just wants to not hurt Superman, but bring him to justice. So they get into it and the fighting begins, and Batman's really giving Superman a beatdown until he tries a very sly move, which is giving him an apparent temporary heart attack. So that way he can fake his own death and continue crime fighting undercover. Nice try. So the next one is another one of my favorites, which is Goku versus Frieza. And interestingly, you know, Frieza also has a lot of similarities, this fight, to a lot of these Superman battles, because it turns out that Frieza just likes to go from planet to planet and enslave people. He basically gives you no choice. And so he's fighting up with Goku's friends and Vegeta, you know, because they're brothers. So sometimes they align and sometimes they fight. So right now they're aligned. And Goku gets there just in time to watch Frieza blast right through Vegeta's chest, and Vegeta's laying there dying, you know. And this is the first time that you see Vegeta get kind of emotional. He's usually very, you know, got a wall up. And so he decides to tell Goku the truth. He said, listen, it was really Vegeta that blew up our planet, and Frieza was kind of Vegeta's boss, because Frieza came on and said, serve me or die. And in order to save his family and the planet, well, Vegeta decides, okay, I will serve you. And well, Frieza just, you know what bad guys do. It's like, how did you not see this coming? Well, Frieza went ahead, killed his family, and just blew up the planet too. And so with his last dying breath, he tells Goku, avenge me, you know, and the Saiyans and the planet, you know, but secretly, you know, he was like mostly like, avenge me. So Goku couldn't take this, and he's, you know, gets very emotional. And by now, if you are a super villain in the Dragon Ball Z world, you know that you probably shouldn't mess with Goku's friends, because it turns out that his emotions and his attachment and compassion for his friends really fuels a lot of his leveling up and a lot of his power. And so the two of them start going at it with various forms of, you know, leveling it up. And Goku even goes Super Saiyan, which is a super high level of being a Saiyan. And the planet even crumbles, because Frieza decides, well, I'm not gonna be able to beat this Goku, so I'm gonna try and just destroy this planet. And they were on a different planet called Namek, and the planet starts to crumble. And Vegeta, at some point, Goku fires a spirit bomb. So this is different than a Kamehameha, because with a spirit bomb, instead of just gathering his own personal force, he gathers it from all the life forms. So this is like a mega finishing move. If you love wrestling, this is gonna be his finishing move. And it turns out that it looks like Frieza is dead once he blasts this thing to Frieza. And he's like, yeah, we won. But it turns out Frieza's not dead. They never are, right? Especially in the Dragon Ball Z world. Whereas in Superman, the fights kind of last a couple comic books and you can collect them into collections. In the Dragon Ball Z world, the fights are more like sagas. They just keep going. So I'm giving you the abridged version, which is not turning out to be too abridged, but I'm gonna try and abridge it now. And so basically, Frieza gets so angry that Goku like thinks that he can kill him, that he goes after his friends, which we all know is a big no-no for Goku, because you're just gonna fuel him and he's gonna beat you. So he kills his best friend Krillin, which causes Goku and him to just go at it again. And Frieza is just at his top 100% of power. But as a result, the damages he's inflicted by Goku just start to really affect him. And he just starts to have a hard time. Finally, in his final moment, he decides to throw a bunch of death saucers at Goku. And Goku outmaneuvers him, creates a dust cloud, and the death saucers, well, they come back at Frieza and just slice him up into like four different pieces. And Frieza, in that moment, says they're very proud warriors. And he says, oh my gosh, I totally can't die this way, like cut up by my own stuff here. So he pleads with Goku, like, do something, like he just can't die in this way. Now, like Superman, Goku doesn't believe in really killing his foe. He wants to bring him to justice, and he feels bad for Frieza. And this has actually helped him out in previous times, where he'll feel compassion for his foe. And a lot of times these guys become his allies. A lot of his friends were once, you know, foes and bad guys. And sometimes people take advantage of it. So we all kind of know which direction this one is going in. So Goku gives him some of his energy to kind of help him recoup. And Frieza takes this energy and tries to fire it back at him. Goku, of course, takes his own energy and then fires it back at Frieza before fleeing the planet, before it crumbles. And so we are led to believe that Frieza died. Led to believe. So in this first drawer, of course, we gotta finish the story with another one of my favorites, Superman versus the Elite. And it's kind of interesting to see all of the different Superman worlds and his belief versus the belief of some of these villains, because Superman, again, wants to bring people to justice, doesn't want to kill anyone. But does that really hold up when the world starts to get really evil and sometimes you might have to do things you don't agree with just to win and make the place a safer place? I mean, you know, even if you look today, it's a very tough conundrum that we all face. So, in looking at the elite, they're a group of superhumans and they call themselves superheroes. So you're like, yay! And the whole world was like, yay, superheroes. And so they go off and they do these seemingly great things. They capture the perpetrator, they kill him, but they also have a ton of civilian casualties and they don't care because at the end of the day, you got the job done and the major foe is gone. Well, Superman takes issue with this because he's like, you really shouldn't be going around killing people, and especially people you can bring to justice. So they have a heated discussion about this, which, abridging it, turns into a fight. And the elite really believes that you do need to kill people to kind of stop this evil. So they're fighting and they're led by Manchester Black, and his superpower is mind control. He can project his thoughts into you, and also telekinesis. So they fight on Jupiter's moon just to kind of keep Earth safe. We don't want a whole big battleground going here. And they get into it. Superman kills all his entire crew, and then finally use his heat vision to lobotomize Manchester Black. And so Manchester says, see, I told you so. And of course, this whole thing is being recorded and televised back down to planet Earth. It's being beamed down. And so Manchester Black said, you just proved my point. You killed us all, and look, you permanently lobotomized me. I can't use my powers anymore. And that's when Superman turns around and says, oh, but not through the power of TV magic. It turns out his whole team was alive. It just was portrayed that they were all dead. And he tells Manchester that all I did was just give you a temporary concussion. You're gonna be good. You're gonna be good. Okay? So he was able to bring them to justice and show the world that you can still be good and use your ways and not have to stoop to the bad guy's level to save the planet. So these are all really great battles that showcases different powers that these guys have, some of the internal struggles that they face. So really quickly, just some of my other favorite ones on the second drawer here, we have Superman versus Darkseid. And basically Darkseid comes, kills, he basically claims he kills Supergirl, and Superman gets super upset. Superman gets super, super upset about this. And they of course have to fight. And then he goes into space with Darkseid and shoves him into the source wall, and that's that. Then because being a warrior is so important in the Dragon Ball Z world, some of these actually come from tournaments, because they have tournaments, not necessarily where they're trying to kill each other, but to see how far they can push their levels in defeating the other opponents. So of course we have Goku versus Jiren, which is probably one of the best tournament fights out there. You can Google some clips to watch that. Of course we have Goku versus Cell, and then Superman versus Thor. And to me, like, some people are very serious about this battle. I just think it's kind of silly, and that's why it's on here, because Thor tries to use his hammer against Superman, and Superman just catches it with one hand like this, and Thor said, almighty, in 9 worlds no one's ever been able to stop his hammer. And Superman, because he's kind of a rocker deep down, Superman says, well, in our world, we turn the dials up to 11. Now, come on, you all know where that's from, right? Come on. Spinal Tap, rock on, Superman. All right. So then after that, of course, no battle chess is also complete without Superman versus Captain Marvel. Now, these guys have been fighting for like more than 70 years. This is like an old married couple defined. They just, you know, but they can't go apart. They just gotta fight, can't live without, can't live with, the whole thing. So there's a huge superhuman war going on, and this has the potential to basically take over the entire world. So Superman and Captain Marvel, also known as Shazam, are duking it out, and Shazam is just throwing a whole bunch of lightning bolts at Superman, and he's just getting pummeled with these lightning bolts. And finally Superman's like quick, and he outmaneuvers Shazam and puts him right in front of the lightning bolt, and the lightning bolt hits him, turning him back into his human form, Billy Batson. So it also turns out that Captain Marvel had been brainwashed by Lex Luthor. So that's gone too. He's regular Billy Batson. And Captain Marvel is kind of neat in that he walks in both worlds. He walks in the human world and he walks in the superhero world as well. So at that time, very much like Goku and Frieza, he gives him a chance and says, I'm gonna give you two choices. Number one, you can kill me right now, but there's a warhead coming. And once that hits, all the superhumans will be dead. Or you can let me take care of that warhead, in which case most likely Superman would die, but then this superhuman war would ravage the entire world. So it was like a lose-lose situation. And in that moment, Billy Batson decided of a third option. So Captain Marvel flies up, throws Superman on the ground, grabs the warhead, screams Shazam three times, and with his lightning, he's able to prematurely detonate this bomb. So not only saving, you know, all the superhumans, but also leaving Superman alive to take care of this superhuman situation. So he sacrifices himself to save the world. So that's a really cool battle. That's from Kingdom Come. And again, all these links after this stream, give me some time. I'll put them all down in case you guys want to find them, read them, kind of refresh your memory on these stories because they're really, really great. So third drawer is just a couple more things. We have Goku versus Kid Buu. And then of course there's Majin Buu and all forms of Buu. Here we have Superman versus Mixius Picklet. And then Superman versus the Wraith, which is fun because he kind of annihilates them, not only in outer space, but also at the center of the Earth. So there's annihilations happening at all stratospheres. And then we have Goku versus Birder and Jace, and then Goku versus Beerus. So all really fun fights, kind of all different power levels and different levels of energy balls. So that's kind of it in the nutshell for all these fun battles. So not only a really useful just in the shop item, but when you spend so much time in the shop, it's just kind of nice to spice things up again so you're not looking at the same kind of dreary workbenches and, you know, standard toolboxes and things. So thrift store people, thrift store. And you have, if you have any questions on how to do this, I've actually since then have done this with car magazines and just different magazines where you can just kind of use it even as wallpaper. You can cover workbenches as well, certain areas. So it's really a lot of fun. But in seeing all these battles, if there's one that you're like, I cannot believe that didn't make your dresser, post it down below. Or if one of these is your absolute favorite, I would love to hear about it. We can talk more battles, but in the end, it's pool time. Which one do you guys think would win in a battle between Superman and Goku? Now that we have seen some of these battles going on, post below. Let's see who ends up being the victor. And until next time, see you guys later.